Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Our next presenter is Richard Dolan. I think most of you probably know Richard by this point. He is now pretty world famous for writing the definitive book about early ufology, the book called UFOs and the National Security State, which pretty much covered the phenomena from the beginning, the early 40s, right up until, I believe, the early 70s. Believe it or not, that book is now 6 years old. It seems like only yesterday when we had Richard come and address the Congress the first time. That was in March 01, 6 years ago. And believe it or not, that was Richard's first public address on the UFO subject. And like all of us, he's been caught up. He's been caught up with this burning need to get to some of the truth about this phenomena. But even more so, about what this phenomena can mean to all of us. Now, Rich is a family man, and he's actually raising his kids right. He's doing something that, well, I would have loved to have done, but didn't, although my girls turned out pretty good. Thank you. But Rich is homeschooling. He is homeschooling his kids. Yeah, that is absolutely worth praise. He's not going to let the national security state educate his kids and brainwash his kids. He's going to do the best he can to raise independent, intelligent, warm-hearted, thinking human beings. How novel. Rich is now working, and has been working honestly for the last 6 years, on completing his second book, UFOs in the National Security State, Part 2. He thinks it's going to be done by the end of this year. However, I promise you, it will be completed before 2012. It's an immense undertaking, and when that book is done, it's going to be current right up until the very day it goes to press. But now, we're going to get Rich up here, and we're going to get into the meat of this. We're going to reflect on this entire wonderful week of education we have had. And Rich is going to lead us into the realm of UFO disclosure. Scenarios and possible outcomes if this should happen. Ladies and gentlemen, Rich Dolan.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you so much.
That was great. Hi. Bob reminded me that the first time I ever spoke in public was 6 years ago here for this Congress, and I was pretty nervous. My book was brand new at the time. I had 1 week notice to get myself out here with a presentation. I was sitting in my office. I got a phone call from Bob Brown, who informed me that they had a late opening for speakers. And he said, would you consider coming out here? And I said, yeah, sure. Thinking, I got a week to put together 90 minutes. I had no PowerPoint, no visuals at all. I just had me. I was the visual. And I went up there, did my little thing, and I was happy to say, very well received. And much of that feeling, that good feeling that I had, was Bob and Terry Brown. When I learned, when I learned of Terry's death, I just remembered how much I owed them both. So I think we should all remember her. And remember, too, that, you know, we're in this field of ours because we want to know things. But what are the important things in our life? They're knowledge, yes. But I think the most important things are developing understanding and kindness and love. We have a short time on this earth. Whether you're here for 10 years or 80, it's short. And we need to remind ourselves to make the most of it, not waste it. So let that be our vow, maybe, when we leave here. What time we have left to make the most of it, okay? And to do good and to make a difference. Okay, didn't expect to get emotional like that. So my theme for today, my quarry to close this conference, I've called UFO Disclosure, Possible Scenarios and Outcomes. I've never really done a talk like this before. Usually when I do this kind of thing, I'm all documents and photographs and cover up this and conspiracy that. That's really not what I'm completely focusing on. That's coming in, don't worry. But I've got a couple of other things in mind for today. Before I get into that, though, the last bit of preface that I want to give you is the progress of my next book. And I don't have to answer too many questions about a conference, only like every 5 minutes. When's the next book coming out? I have been working on it like a crazy man for the last, well, 5-6 years since the first book came out. You have to realize when I finished that first book, I essentially wanted to drop dead of exhaustion and take a long vacation. But the problem was that I had to get up to speed on the last 30, 35 years of history, and I really had not by the time I finished that first book. I was racing and racing and racing to just get everything done for that book. And so it took several years of research. The research that I've gathered together for this second volume is 6 to 7 times the amount for me to go through. It's a huge amount of data. I almost collected too much. But I'm in the process of writing it. I'm very happy with the writing of it, I will say that. And it's going to be a long book, a lot longer than the first one. I'm guessing maybe 700 pages or so. It's just huge. But it will be done this year. It will definitely, I'm pretty confident in saying, be done before December 21st, 2012, the end of our civilization. Not sure if I'm a 2012-er. Can we use that word, a 2012-er? I think that maybe I am, but maybe I'm not. I think that we're going through very, very dramatic, rapid changes, and I'll be talking about those. So, I think something very big is happening, and maybe it will indeed happen in 2012. We'll see. So today I've got UFO Disclosure, Possible Scenarios and Outcomes. I want to give you my plan. First, briefly, I don't want to get into too much UFO history today. A little bit. A short history of how I interpret the last 50 or so years of attempts at disclosure. It's got a long history. Why disclosure is impossible, but then why it is inevitable. Because it's both. It is impossible, and it is inevitable. It will happen. And then various scenarios that I'm thinking about, and can tell you about. So the efforts to end UFO secrecy go back a long way, almost 60 years, almost as long, I love to use this analogy sometimes, as the age of the Soviet Union before it collapsed. The analogy is not a bad one. When you have a society built on a fundamental falsehood or a series of falsehoods, you have to wonder how long it can last before the foundation cracks. That's what we're thinking, that's what we're looking at here. In the 1940s, there wasn't really an absolute disclosure movement per se. There was a crisis that erupted publicly in 1947. We all know about this. Most prominently, Roswell. There was some a flurry of press coverage on these flying saucers, a lot of open speculation. And then it stopped shortly after the Roswell event occurred. Actually, the press just kind of fell off the deep end there. Well, there wasn't an organized movement to tell the public about all of this. We do know that matters within some classified circles came to a head in the summer of 1948 with what was called the estimate of the situation. And this is simply a report generated by analysts at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base on these flying saucers. There is no copy of the estimate that exists to this day, but we're pretty darn sure that it landed on the desk, that's my nifty little laser pointer, of Air Force General Hoyt Vandenberg, who is right there. The estimate said that some of these flying saucers appear to be interplanetary. Vandenberg, according to what we believe we know, said, "I don't like that conclusion, give me something else," and then shortly after that disbanded the team that came up with that. We have to remember that the 1940s were very different from today. People actually believed in their government. They trusted it. And so I think the idea, the mentality of the time was, well, let's work this out and find out what we're dealing with. Now, at higher classified circles, there's no question in my mind that there were people who knew what was going on. And in my own mind, my own thinking about this is, you know, it's very easy for me to see someone like Harry Truman being presented with the information that, yes, we have apparently recovered technology that was not made by human hands, and then having to decide what to do about that. And thinking, well, let's take a look at this technology, see if we can get any nifty ideas out of it. Let's certainly keep it away from the Soviets, because recall, we Americans didn't even want to share atomic technology, much less something as exotic as alien technology. And certainly, let's not alarm the public just yet. Let's find out what we're dealing with. I could see all of these things going through the mind of someone like Truman. It's not hard to see why secrecy would have started when it did. But the 1950s, though, there were some people who were beginning to get wise to the fact that there may be something to this flying saucer phenomenon. We get the first challenges to government authority on the topic. First, you get the crisis of 1952, when flying saucers were being seen in many, many, many places, including by many military people. This photograph here, it's hard to see. There are images up there. Some analysts have argued that, in fact, these lights here are reflections, optical reflections of these lights here. Maybe. Maybe not. There were definite UFOs over the Capitol throughout several weekends in the summer of 1952. That's absolute unquestionable. This is Donald Kehoe, who was the early and longtime director of NICAP, and that was the first civilian organization really to challenge the Air Force publicly on the matter of UFOs. The method that NICAP employed at that time was very much in line with what you'd expect from 1950s America, which was that we are going to work within the system. Let's work with Congress. That's our government, right? We elect our congressional representatives. So we'll work with members of Congress to see about getting the matter of UFOs a public hearing, open hearings. This was the annual goal that NICAP had. And you know, there were many times when it appeared NICAP was very, very close to getting those hearings. And inevitably at the 11th hour, a congressman would tell Kehoe, well, look, we're close, but we don't really have enough guys. Let's go for it for next year. And next year never came. Next year almost came in 1962, and that came out from underneath them as well. This, by the way, you can't even see this at all. I'm sorry that it didn't come out. But in light of the video that Jaime and Santiago showed earlier, the Mexican UFOs, this is from 1952, and this is a clip of from the film of taken in Trimington, Utah by Delbert Newhouse. And if you really get a good look at it, looks a lot like some of the Mexican UFOs, only this is 1952. The arguments that Kehoe and the other members of NICAP had about UFOs and the need for disclosing were explicitly patriotic. In other words, they were saying, look, military is telling their personnel that there's nothing to these UFOs, apparently, and yet what happens if we mistake a UFO for a Soviet missile and accidentally start World War III? In fact, I don't really think that was ever a danger at that time because I think the proper circles were informed all right. But still, it was a good argument to make, and that was the kind of argument that I think worked well with the public, and it was their kind of leverage to sort of open this issue up. But it didn't happen. By the 1960s, the battle continued in a different light. We had numerous sightings, especially peaking in the mid-60s, 65, 66, in this country. By the way, I'm switching laser pointers here. Can you see that? No, that's the dinky little thing. That is an early, possibly the first good color photograph of a UFO taken in 1965. This is the Heflin photograph, also from 1965. For a while, that photograph was disputed, but it's authentic, totally authentic. And in fact, you can see below it is a disturbance in the ground caused by this object, apparently. And this is one of several photographs that were taken that day. The matter was such a big deal that it actually did threaten to get an open congressional hearing. And in fact, for one day in 1966, it did, pretty much a disappointment. But the Air Force was very smart. And the Air Force thought, you know, let's just take the initiative here and deal with this problem before someone else deals with it. And what the Air Force did was to initiate a formal scientific official study of UFOs that we've come to know as the Condon Committee. One of the things that they tried and didn't quite succeed to do is to enlist the support of the major UFO organizations at the time. Smart move, because if you're going to debunk this, you want to bring in the UFO believer organizations. The problem was everyone sort of could tell right from the beginning that there were some serious problems of objectivity with the Condon Committee. There was kind of a mass firing midway through and a lot of other things. That's Edward Condon. I'm switching my laser pointers. You can get a really good idea of how he looked at this whole thing. I mean, this is a goofy flying saucer model on top of the stack of his report, and Condon just thinks it's all a big joke. The report came out in at the end of the 60s and early 69 and basically said nothing to this, no scientific value, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, it's true, the internals of the report vastly contradicted that conclusion, but we all know that. It appeared to end, possibly, the whole UFO matter at that time. Goodbye, UFOs. Well, the aliens who were operating the UFOs must not have read the report because they kept out there. They were continuing to be seen. Tactics changed a little bit in the 1970s. Ufology, as it started to call itself, regrouped. And in fact, really in the 1970s, you get the beginnings of what we now have sometimes still called scientific ufology. So the basic idea was, look, let's not do this political thing. Let's not fight the government. What we need to do is methodically, scientifically, carefully do this topic in a scientifically respectable way so that we can get academic support and become established in that way. Laudable, understandable. Didn't really happen to the extent that I think its practitioners wanted it to. Political thing in our country in the mid-70s was that we had Watergate, we had Vietnam, which ended. It was a reaction against, rightly perceived, I would say, a vastly overweening executive branch that made its own early attempt at instituting something of a police state in this country. As a result of that, Congress, in really its last great hurrah, attempted to reassert itself. We had, you know, you may remember the hearings on the assassinations that took place in the mid-70s. We had really the first and only true attempt by Congress to look into the workings of the U.S. intelligence community, including the NSA for the very first time, CIA, and so on. One thing that came out of it was a strengthening of the Freedom of Information Act, and that had massive consequences for researchers. So much so that by the late 1970s, out of nowhere, come thousands of pages of documents pertaining to this UFO cover-up. FBI, CIA, Army Intelligence, all the acronyms kept saying, we don't know nothing about no UFOs. Suddenly, we find out, oh, yeah, you do. Got some serious military reports in the process. No true smoking gun, no memo from the president saying, what are we going to do about these darned aliens? But a couple that are a cut below, one cut below, that describe awesome encounters by military personnel with what can only be called UFOs, objects that look disc-shaped, that could stop on a dime at times, move in zigzags and do all kinds of crazy things, but they did them, hanging out over sensitive installations and so on, getting very serious concern. And those documents, some of them did come out. Now that's something. The hope at the time among researchers was this was the new tool to break the wall of secrecy. We can do it. We've got our new way, kind of like a loophole. You know, Condon Committee slammed the door, but FOIA, Freedom of Information Act, is going to reopen that door. And there was a lot of hope, and it legitimately so, but it didn't happen. Even in the glory era under basically President Carter, FOIA was tough. The most top secret documents were really not released, the highest level secrecy, in other words. And we were getting stuff that was a little bit lower levels of secrecy. Interesting, yeah, but not quite what was sought after. The other thing that happened in the 70s, which may have had even greater repercussions, were the development of some really significant leaks out of the military and intelligence community. The absolute leader in obtaining information in the early years was Leonard Stringfield. Stringfield had fought in World War II himself, and everyone who knew him seemed to hold him in very high respect. I regret that I never had the chance to meet Mr. Stringfield. But by the late 70s, after he had written a book called Situation Red, a lot of military people started to come to him with stories of crashed disks, seeing dead alien bodies in storage at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base and things like this. And Stringfield collected dozens and then scores of such accounts and then began to publish those. We also have the entry of Stanton Friedman talking about Roswell. He met Jesse Marcel Sr. in 1978, and the Roswell case began to reassert itself. And a number of other crash retrievals as well were being discussed. So the combination of that plus the Freedom of Information Act documents, all in a brief period of time, prompted what I consider to be a counterattack by the national security state. One thing that they did in the infamous Benowitz affair, Paul Benowitz was a defense contractor and scientist who lived right across from Manzano Range by Kirtland Air Force Base and saw what he thought were UFOs. He might have seen UFOs. I don't totally buy the explanation that he was only seeing totally terrestrial tests. There were, in my opinion, legitimate UFO accounts out by Manzano. But in any case, he was seeing something and getting very worked up over it. And what Air Force Office of Special Investigation, in particular Richard Doty, did was to co-opt UFO researchers, most notably William Moore, to feed disinformation to Benowitz. Benowitz ended up losing his mind. Moore ended up losing his reputation. And we ended up with the MJ-12 documents and a lot of other things. Now, my theory on the MJ-12 documents, I don't know if I'm right, but my theory is that they are based on true documents released in such a way as to be unusable by researchers. You know, you take a truth and you package it between two pieces of junk or false data, then that makes the truth unusable. It's like an inoculation. You go to the doctor, get inoculated against a disease, they give you a little bit of the disease so that your body learns to fight it off. You're inoculated. In the same way, truths can be given out, packaged in such a way that they're not believable forever, so that the next time that information comes out, you can all say, oh yeah, but that's a lot of BS. And this is what I personally think is the case of the MJ-12 documents. There were also attacks and machinations against Leonard Stringfield himself, which I believe were part of the same concerted effort at around that time. So in other words, it looked like something might happen in the late 70s, and it didn't happen. we ended up with a lot of confusion. In the 1980s, we saw more leaks, and the leaks got even more serious. We started getting leaks about Area 51. Good thing we were getting some leaks because the Freedom of Information Act was becoming almost even then totally emasculated in a number of ways. There was an executive order in 1982 that basically exempted NORAD completely from FOIA and other agencies. It was just a very expensive and unrealistic avenue for many researchers who just didn't have that much money. I mean, some of the fees requested were in the many thousands of dollars to get the documents. It just couldn't happen. There were a number of people, though, digging. I have the name of James Goodall right here. James Goodall wasn't a UFO researcher. He was an aviation aerospace writer. Started cultivating people inside Area 51, Nevada testing range, the Nellis testing range. People were telling him, yeah, we got some pretty funky stuff out there, things that would make George Lucas envious. Circa 1985, pretty good. Rumors about reverse engineering alien craft, even before Bob Lazar hit the scene in 88, 89, these were bubbling about, these rumors. I have the name of Robert Sarbacher here. Sarbacher was a defense scientist in the 50s, and it came out that he had had a series of high-level meetings dealing with concerning the UFO phenomenon and alien beings. And Sarbacher confirmed it in a two-page typewritten letter to a UFO researcher who asked him about it. And Sarbacher said, yeah, we did. We talked about it. We even talked a little bit about, or I heard the scuttlebutt, he said, as to the nature of these aliens, called them insect-like. Okay. So then we come to the 90s, and other initiatives continued. You know, so far we've got decade after decade of failure, but the initiatives keep coming. We have what was what many people now call the Rockefeller Initiative. When Bill Clinton was elected president, Lawrence Rockefeller, who had an interest in UFOs, gee, isn't that interesting? Why would Lawrence Rockefeller have an interest in UFOs? I have an idea. Rockefeller Estate, Pocantico's in Lower New York State. In the early 80s, there was a massive wave called the Hudson Valley wave, you know, sightings. Triangles flying over the Taconic Parkway, low, 100, 200 feet altitude, huge triangles at times, silent, sometimes shining a huge beam of light down on the road, I mean, right out of the movies, and then, taking off. This went on for years. I'll guarantee you some of them flew over the Rockefeller Estate. Now, if a triangle flies over your house, you might not be able to do much about it, but if you're a Rockefeller, you might. And it wouldn't shock me at all if that was one reason that Lawrence Rockefeller had such an interest in this. I don't know. Never got the chance to talk to the man. But anyway, he made an initiative to Bill Clinton as a way to try to open up the UFO issue. And that essentially devolved into what became like the Roswell Initiative. I mean, all efforts began to focus on opening up the Roswell records. And that ended in absolute failure. And the reason it did, the Air Force did almost a complete same strategy that they did back in the 60s. Roswell events becoming more and more talked about. Air Force very intelligently decided to be the first out with a report on Roswell because the General Accounting Office of Congress was going to do a study on Roswell, right? Then the Air Force hustles together this report issued out in September of 94 that said, no, it was, we were being a little deceptive. Yeah, it's true. We were doing flights of this mogul balloon apparatus, and a year later, then they came out with the crash test dummies. A couple of years later. And then in 95, the GAO came out with their report, finally, which said, well, as a matter of fact, we tried getting records out of Roswell Army Airfield, and the records were missing. From late 46 into 49. Records that should never have been destroyed were destroyed, no reason given. Now, had that come out first, I bet there might have been a little more inquiry. But the Air Force report had already been out. The Air Force really handled this perfectly. Then we get some other initiatives. I'm interested in some of the things Stephen Greer did in the 1990s. I missed Greer, Dr. Greer, when he was here earlier this week. You know, I'm sure he realizes what a polarizing figure he can be. There are people who love him and people who hate him. I'm neither. I acknowledge a lot of very good things that Stephen Greer actually has done. One of the things he did in 1993, at the end of that year, was to meet with then CIA Director James Woolsey. Now, people have argued, because Dr. Greer's called it a briefing, and this meeting was arranged by John Peterson of the Arlington Institute, a man who's very powerful himself, and those three men and their wives met at Peterson's home. A couple of years later, Greer mentioned this as a briefing to the director of the CIA, and Peterson and Woolsey immediately said, no, it wasn't a briefing, what are you, nuts? It was just a gathering, just an informal dinner. Okay, well, you know, you can split hairs if you want, but if I had a meeting with the director of the CIA right now at his home, and I was there for over 3 hours, I think it's not that much of a stretch to call it a briefing. How are you going to get into the home of, a friend of the CIA director and meet with the director of the CIA for that long a period of time? No one, you don't just do that sort of thing. Okay, so it meant something. And Stephen Greer was able to do that. In 1997, an even more significant meeting took place, in my opinion. And this is something that I have independent knowledge of. in April of 97, Dr. Greer and astronaut Edgar Mitchell did, in fact, have a meeting with the head of intelligence of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, a man named Thomas Wilson, an admiral. In fact, Greer made this claim in his latest book, and not a lot of people seem to have taken notice of it. I really don't know why. I knew about this. I had a different source of information who had told me about this before Dr. Greer's book came out. And I had information that's a little bit different, slightly different than what Greer reported. And that information is that, as Greer says, he met and Dr. Mitchell met with Admiral Wilson and talked about the special access programs within the Pentagon that were designed to study alien technology and bodies, and saying that, you know, these are rogue private groups. They're essentially, our information tells us that they're beyond Pentagon control, and we need you to look into this. And the one thing in Greer's book that he mentioned was that Wilson told him, in fact, that yes, he had tried to look into it and could not, and he was denied access, and it bothered him. That's pretty close, in fact. It's pretty close. My source, I can't get into who it is. Sorry, it's a source that I trust as much as I can trust. And what happened was that Greer and Mitchell met with Wilson, told him what they believed was the case, that these deep black programs existed beyond government control. Wilson said he would look into it. Did look into it. 3 months later, discovered that it was true. Denied access to the programs, despite the fact that he was head of intelligence of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Wow. And came away very upset about it. I called Thomas Wilson a couple of months ago, spoke to him. He was not happy about my phone call. He said, oh, I vaguely remember that meeting. Vaguely. Oh, yes, I remember now. Right. It was right about that topic. Well, I had a lot of things to do at that time, and I was working very long hours. And, I just don't really think that there is anything to this. In fact, I call all of that just poppycock. He used the word poppycock. Who uses that word? So he denied it. Of course, I mean, if you admit that you had this meeting, and if you admit that you were denied access to these programs, frankly, that's enough to bring the house down, in addition to losing all of your security clearances and so on. So I can't blame him or fault him for saying what he did. But I don't believe him either. So I mention these as initiatives to kind of obtain a sort of disclosure, or at least to educate some of the responsible leaders of this country of what was going on. And they didn't result in breaking through the ice, it's true. A couple of things, though, changed our world. One was the internet in the 1990s. This is obviously quite significant. If you restrict access to information, you can maintain secrecy. If you have something like the internet, that can make secrecy, theoretically, a little more difficult to obtain. And I think that the internet's had a major impact. One of the things that it did, not a big deal in my opinion, but it's worth mentioning, is that I think it's weakened some of the major UFO organizations, which in past years had more of a lock on this topic. Now you've got, I mean, you've got anyone can start up a website and kind of do their own thing. In the 2000s, in the last decade, there's been much more use of media and internet. Probably the biggest event, though, I think, of the decade in terms of forcing disclosure was the press conference that Stephen Greer held in spring of 01. When my book came out, a few people contacted me and said, you know, this is kind of up your alley a little bit because you write about UFO conspiracies and cover-ups. Do you think that the Greer press conference is going to break through this? And I said, no, I don't. I'm sorry to say that I was right. I think the press conference was a good idea that was mangled and botched. And it was botched through a classic case of overreach. You know, you've got this full house. Tough to do. He did it. Got these awesome witnesses to talk about UFO secrecy from the inside. Very credible people, most of them very credible, I thought. And then blew it by really getting into a political agenda that really had no place in that press conference. Why burden yourself, right though you may be, with trying to ban space-based weapons? Come on, fight one battle per day. I think it's quite enough to prove that the UFO cover-up is real. Then describe the nature of the aliens as good, and to tell the world that we're alienating the aliens by weaponizing space, whether or not that's true. Just chill, one battle at a time. And I think it helped to damage the credibility of that conference. My Monday morning quarterbacking, but hey. In the last decade, we've had a number of statements by other governments. Actually, those statements go back for decades and decades. I mean, there's been periodically suggestive statements by other governments, other governmental leaders, about the reality of UFOs. The question is, will any of those break the wall of secrecy? So far, none of them have. And there have been some pretty suggestive statements by some very responsible people from around the world. And they just get no play in the US media. None. What we do have is UFOs kind of pervading our culture more and more. I mean, think back to 20, 25 years. I mean, it was just not the same way as what we have today. We had the show Sightings, we had the X-Files, and now we've got the show Roswell, and we've got the Teletubbies and Boobah for kids. Has anyone seen these shows? Raise your hand. No one? Weird, man. Weird. These freaky little alien puppets flying around in spaceships. And hey, kids, you know, here's your alien friends. They're everywhere. That's not all good for us, but it does, you know, make the UFO phenomenon very, very widespread. And then you get pictures like this coming out. I mean, this is going to break the secrecy. The photographer, I know for a fact, who did this was terminated with extreme prejudice. Wasn't there one of this with Clinton and this alien? Yeah, I thought so. Couldn't find that one. Well, the president's a reptilian. We kind of knew that. We kind of knew it. Let's face it. All right, if you don't agree, I don't want to. Yes, he is, so. One of the major roadblocks has been throughout the media, mainstream media, pretty much in every case, in my opinion. When I wrote my book, when I was working on it in the 90s, late 90s, I thought, well, I had this fond fantasy that somehow my book might just be, you know, maybe this will break the secrecy. I'm just going to lay the case out as clearly as I can, and who knows? Well, you know, I mean, some people like my book, and that's gratifying, but no, it did not do it. The problem is getting media coverage, getting the serious kind of media coverage that would give this issue traction. I mean, look, we just had the famous O'Hare sighting a few months ago. I did a little spot myself on CNN about this. And what has happened to the O'Hare incident? It's, you know, dropped into the black hole of the media. It's gone. And that's a heck of a sighting. That's a good case. And maybe it will continue to get some traction, but I think it's done. The limited coverage that there has been over many, many years. I mean, you know, 4 years ago, there was the sighting over near DC, the F-16s following this bluish object across the sky. This is, less than a year after 9/11. Got a little bit of coverage and then just gone. Why? Well, maybe one reason, I think definitely one reason, is that US media has a long, long history of being connected with the US intelligence community. And it's true. We know this. Independent of the UFO phenomenon, there have been many, many good, serious, sober, scholarly studies done on this. It's a fact. Does that mean that the CIA controls everything to the media? No. It means that the CIA and other intelligence agencies exert dominant influence when they need to at certain times to manage certain issues. Yes. Yes, they do. Of course they do. In the late 90s, when Joe Firmage was very, very prominent in the UFO field for a few years, he sponsored what was called a contact planning scenario. This was actually mentioned in public a few months ago by Michael Lindemann. Michael Lindemann was one of the participants in this, and a number of other people were involved. It was a purely private initiative sponsored by Joe Firmage and involved a serving three-star general and a number of other scientists and other important private individuals. And what they tried to do was to lay out the various parameters of how would contact occur between us and another civilization, okay? And they went through all these various factors. The relative speed of arrival would be a factor in how we might respond. I mean, if we detected a signal way, way, way off in the distance and it takes time for them to get here, we would have time to prepare. That would be one factor. If they just come like War of the Worlds, that would be a different kind of scenario. The degree of familiarity of these others, if they were like us, if they were not like us. And then they created a wide range of scenarios, basically ranging from a very benign space brothers are here to help us out to like a War of the Worlds scenario with a lot of variables in between. And trying to figure out how, you know, the various government, science, business, religion, media, public, all of those sectors of our society, how they would react. It was an interesting study. The people who participated in it, I think, felt that they got a lot out of it. And this was done purely as a private initiative. I know, however, that there was a classified, there have been several, actually, from what I understand, classified versions of this type of thing, only it's not a contact planning scenario. It's a disclosure scenario, a series of studies. Now, I don't have a lot of detail about this, unfortunately. But I do know that it's taken place at very high levels. And the real question is, how do we prepare the world, the public, with this reality? Not, you know, are aliens coming from out there, but the fact that they are here and that the UFO phenomenon, yeah, it's real. Okay? That's a different thing than the contact planning scenario. All right? In other words, how do we disclose? I'm telling you that this topic has come up in highly classified environments. I don't know many of the details about that, but I can figure out a couple of things, okay, as can all of us. The questions among this group of people were asked, basically, how will this affect our society? If the president were to tell the world that yes, aliens are real, they're among us, okay, what would the repercussions be? What would the religious implications be? What would happen to billions of people who rely on a very simplistic let's say, worldview of how their religion, what their religion tells them. I mean, the people here, I think we can safely say, are some very, very intellectually unique and special and some very brilliant people. Every time I come to a conference, I meet just amazing people. And I've met some this week, some incredibly brilliant and beautiful people who certainly think outside the box, but most people do not think that much outside the box. So one of the issues to be that was discussed was, would this be a religious problem? Well, probably would. Some of the other problems were economic, okay? One issue that was in fact discussed, that I know was discussed, were the seemingly mundane issue of lawsuits. So for example, if I'm a defense contractor and this other company, they're a defense contractor, and then I discover that they obtained access to alien technology, and I didn't, and I lost out on some contracts, hey, maybe I would sue. There might be a lot of those. There might be a lot of gnarly little legal technical issues that would just promise to be an incredible nightmare for many people. What would happen to the oil industry? What would happen to the steel industry? What would happen to the automotive industry? Now, we can think about this and think, well, you know, fine, so they're gone, great. But to the planners, this could be a problem because that's a lot of their power. And it would cause economic disruption. It could feasibly, yes, of course it could, at least in the short term. Energy. Now, I don't know that this was discussed. I'm going to guess that this was discussed. All right, let's say that the disclosure of UFOs is alien. Now we get into the whole issue of free energy, because look, it's obvious, someone's gonna say, well, great, you've got this technology. So you really have been studying it secretly all these years. Okay, well, let's have it. So let's say that there is, let's call it free energy, whether it's the application of the zero-point energy field or something else, okay? Whatever that is. Because look, whatever these saucers and triangles are flying, it's not 100-octane gasoline. They're flying something pretty funky, right? Makes you go silent and shoo, take off instantly without making a sound. It's something. And some of us poor slobs here might want to use it because maybe, just maybe, we're hitting an oil crisis. Yes, I think we are. But what if the source of energy that's available, in addition to heating your house for free for the rest of your life, can also make a really neat bomb? Okay? And what if there's not a truly secure way to control that and prevent some person or group from blowing up half of a continent? I don't know that this is the case, but I have to wonder. What if, following disclosure, we learn how to manipulate time? A lot of people have been talking about time travel. Certainly, if you can manipulate the gravitic field, a lot of people feel you can manipulate time. If you can manipulate time sufficiently, could that have serious economic ramifications, like what would happen to the stock market? Simple matter. What if we learn after disclosure that all of us possess certain psychic or spiritual abilities? Now look, the people, all of us here, I think, again, we're at a different place in that. And frankly, that's not a problem necessarily, right? That's a great thing. But again, for those people who are in charge of the secret, what if that's a problem for them? And what if, as I'm sure has happened, we discover that the UFO secret has gone private? In other words, has gone beyond government, has gone into very powerful behind government types of groups. Let's face it, that's happened regarding everything, not just UFOs. I mean, what government is truly sovereign anymore? Do you think the president of the United States is really your president? Get real. That president is the president of multinational, major financial interests that totally dominate him. Why would it be any otherwise regarding access to the UFO technology? Okay? And would that cause a serious political problem? Yeah, I think it would. And some exopolitical problems. The stuff that I was just dealing with, that's all domestic stuff, right? Big deal. What if we learn that some of the aliens look just like us and live among us? There have been many speakers this last week who have discussed this. I think it's true, by the way. I do. I'll tell you why. One perfect reason, this is my speculation purely, but I can't leave this speculation. An alien comes to Earth, let's say they come from somewhere else, maybe they just can't walk around on the surface of the planet, maybe the sun's not good for them. What might they do? Well, I think one thing they might do is to build a secure environment for themselves, maybe underground. Yeah, I think underground. But you might want to interact with the world on topside every so often, right? So how do you do that? Well, you can fly around in your craft, but you might just want to breed your own group of humans, take them downstairs and enhance them probably, maybe genetically manipulate them, put different kinds of implants in them so that they can be just what you want them to be, and then you send them back up. I would do it if I were an alien, yes. Personally, I think that they have. I can't prove it, but there are many, many credible accounts, in my view, of people who have encountered human-looking individuals who just don't seem quite human. I'm sure we are all familiar with these stories. And so what would happen if we discovered that that was the case? Could that be a problem if you're a planner for disclosure? Yeah, I think that could be a big problem. Can you imagine vigilante groups? Right? You're an alien. Get them. Yeah, I can imagine that. What if, because if I were to send humans, my own humans, up to the surface of civilization, I don't think I'd have them sweeping the floors. I think I'd have them doing something, you know, kind of interesting. What if they're in positions of power? Shades of David Icke. What if it's true? Seriously? Could it be true? Of course it could be true. Of course it could be true. What if it is? What if we learn that there are many of them and they don't all get along with each other? Okay? What then? If you are in charge of releasing this secret and you know that there are 3 or 57 groups here, whatever, and that that group really doesn't like that group, how do you deal with that? I don't know. What if we learn that our militaries and at least some of the aliens have been fighting each other all these years? Looks like it to me. U.S. has been sending interceptors up aloft for years and years and years trying to intercept these UFOs and shoot them down. Soviets have tried it, as Paul Stonehill pointed out earlier today. Lost a lot of aircraft in doing so. For my next book, I have recounted scores of accounts, hundreds actually, of accounts of attempted intercepts of apparently alien craft. I don't know about hundreds, but lots. And this is a policy that has not ceased to this very day.
What if we find out that we've been fighting them? Yes. And what if we learned that they have created us? Right? Like this. Look at some of these old pictures I'm showing you here. This is a Sahara rock drawing. Most of you have seen these, I'm sure. Rock drawing from 6000 BC. Okay, can you all see that? There's a little kind of a flying saucer type object, right? There, okay. What is this guy? What is this? I don't really know what these are, but they are very suggestive to me. This is another BC painting from Italy. I don't know that they're space people, but they certainly look like they could be. The Voisina in Australia. We've all seen these images. Okay, they don't look like Australian Aborigines to me. They're sky people, we're told. This is from a cave painting from about 15,000 BC. And I've enlarged, well, you can see, some of these have been seen before, but this business here looks interesting and intriguing. Again, I just offer this. This is a Tibetan manuscript from the 10th century AD, and you can see, you can see it looks like a flying object behind the head of that person there. None of that proves that we have a long history of alien encounters, but they are suggestive. I'm inclined to think that it was the case. Political problems continuing. How do you undo a lie this big? Can a power structure actually survive such disclosure? I think it's possible. Maybe not. I would like to think not, but in fact, I think it is possible. How would it be possible? Well, you can impose a global police state through brute force. Let's face it. It's possible. It's happening now. What we have today are two factions, basically. You have the faction for global fascism, and you got a faction for freedom. And that has not been played out. I know what side we're all on, okay? This fight is not done. They can also manage and survive through effective spin of the disclosure. It's not hard to explain how that can happen. Now, my own feeling is that if and when disclosure happens, it will happen. It's probably going to be forced. I don't think it's going to be done voluntarily by any government, certainly not the U.S. government. I think the issue will have to be forced upon them. What can force disclosure? I'll tell you what can do it. I'm going to give you a very short history again, because I love doing history. It's like my thing. That and the future now. I seem to be doing more future thinking than historical thinking these days. We all know that we're in a completely revolutionary era. But we don't always really appreciate that, I think. I mean, you wake up one morning and like this is just like yesterday kind of, and yesterday's kind of like the day before that. And yeah, you got that new iPod last month and that was kind of cool. And you upgraded your computer a month before that and that was kind of neat. When you add it all up, whoa, okay, now we see that this is like very different from 10 years ago and from 20 years ago. And we can kind of see that we are in something very, very unprecedented. So let's go back 10,000 years. Well, oh no, we got to do this. See how we're progressing, guys. I want some ice cream, bad. Okay, the ancient people, they didn't have ice cream. Here we are 10,000 years ago. This is an artist's rendition. Can you all see that? Kind of. At night, you know, I don't really read a lot of UFO stuff. I read basic history and philosophy. I do UFOs in the daytime. That's like my day job. There are people here, let me use my better laser pointer, who they're cutting wild wheat. This is the origins of agriculture. And they're using these little stone tools, right? Little stone sickles. Okay? 10,000 years later, in the 15th century, I want you to take a look. I'll show you right here. This man is using, look at his tool there, sickle, metal, a little bit better than stone, yeah, true. They're dressed a little bit nicer. They're using the wheel here, that's kind of neat, but everything's basically muscle power still. 10,000 years had gone by. 10,000 years had gone by, and guess what? Still basically the same. 19th century, this is an image by Van Gogh from the late 19th century, and is a peasant. And look what he's using, okay? All right? Not much changed. That's 120 some odd years ago. This is a photograph from 1888. It's a beautiful photograph, all right? It's of a sailing ship here that's in some trouble. There's a guy on a horse, a bunch of people. There's some other horses here you can't see, and got rowboats. I mean, that's state of the art, 1888. That's 125 or 30 years ago. And then we get this, and then we get that, and then we get a whole lot of those. Then we get radio and the early telephone. Gee, world's changing real fast. Then we get this. That's 1945. That's like nothing. You go from the 1880s to this in about a little over 50 years. Wow. How did that happen? Remember the Commodore 64? We're into the 1980s. We're getting computers. And then we get these computers. And we've transformed our entire society. It's an image of the world at night, tough to see in the light. You've all seen pictures like this. Here's our world today. I want to point out a couple of things here. You got a integrated circuit. You got virtual reality. You got satellites. And this is not a person. That's an android, a Japanese android. You can talk to her if you knew Japanese, and she would answer you. And she blinks, and she gesticulates, and she sounds intelligent, sort of. She can't stand quite. That is, I have her leaning, but that will come. Okay? This was a presentation earlier in 2006. Now, she doesn't have the intelligence of a human being yet. That will come. That's a transformation. Where are we going? Let's take a look into the near future. One of my side interests, a little bit of a side interest, is machine intelligence, artificial intelligence. There are a number of writers who are looking at this very seriously, and I try to keep abreast of what they're talking about because, hey, look, if they're right about what they think, this is going to affect everything here that we're discussing in our field. Why? Well, let's find out. Ray Kurzweil, a writer who I admire and enjoy, he wrote a book called The Age of Spiritual Machines and another book called The Singularity is Near. A writer named Damian Broderick, who wrote a book called The Spike, all talk about what future computing is going to probably be like. Kurzweil, at one point, speculated on by the year 2019, so like a little more than a decade from now. And he wrote that Age of Spiritual Machines in 1999, so that's almost already becoming a little old. Computers embedded everywhere. They're already becoming embedded everywhere. I have a clock that can land a small aircraft in my backyard. I feel like my coffee maker is right there, too. Virtual reality will become very common. Computer assistance, common. Here's the thing. The leading computer is expected to equal one human brain about a decade from now. Now, by that, you know, there are computers that can defeat Garry Kasparov at chess. True. But even those computers could not, if you put them in an android body, they couldn't catch a fly ball to center field because there are certain things that the human brain does very naturally that a computer can't yet do. But these things are being worked on. And in fact, there is a program to digitize a pattern of the human brain and create a computer program based on human thinking. So the idea is you'll have human-style brain thinking, but with the ability to, you know, calculate a quadrillion number of calculations per second and pull any bit of data off the internet instantly. So it'll be like you or me, but with an IQ of, take your pick, 100,000, whatever. Real smart. Okay? Real smart. I've heard that, in fact, within national security circles, they're working on such a program right now. And the question is what brain to base the computer on. And, well, it's quite logical to base that on the brain of your elected leader, George W. Bush. I mean, he is the president, right? I got a couple of bugs with it, from what I understand. One is that although it's based in Texas, that apparently it's controlled by the Skull and Bones International Crime Syndicate. Also requires 320 days of vacation a year, so it's, you know, kind of buggy. Back to the year 2019. It is believed that the human genome will be completely understood and we'll have the beginnings of nanotechnology. I want to get a little more into nanotech. What is nanotechnology? Good definition is the engineering of functional systems at the molecular scale. One writer calls it the next industrial revolution. I'm going to read this quote here because it may be hard for you to see this. This is a quotation from the United States National Science Foundation. Imagine a medical device that travels through the human body to seek out and destroy small clusters of cancerous cells before they can spread. Or a box no larger than a sugar cube that contains the entire contents of the Library of Congress. Or materials much lighter than steel that possess 10 times as much strength. Now that last makes me think of Roswell. something that's really, really light and really, really strong. And I wonder, was the Roswell craft the product of nanotech? And I'm inclined to guess it very well may have been. They're talking about having your own personal nano factory in the future. This is an artist's rendition. This is not an actual nano factory, okay? You can't go out and get this at Walmart just yet. But it's believed that it's only a matter of time until the building of products becomes as cheap as the copying of files. A nano factory might contain lots of miniature chemical processors, computing, and robotics, producing items cheaply, cleanly, and quickly, directly from blueprints. Kind of like the replicator on Star Trek, right? Tea, Earl Grey, hot. The other thing about these nanofactories is that it's possible that you can get an exponential proliferation of them. And in other words, nanofactories making more nanofactories. You can see where this might go. And this, of course, could be a problem because, again, like with possible free energy, what if you can make a really wicked weapon with some nanofactories? I mean, I could see that happening. The predictions are this can happen anywhere from 10 years from now to maybe a little over 30 years from now. But it's believed it will happen. We are really recreating our civilization in a major way, as we can now see. Future machines, will they be like an iRobot, a movie I enjoyed very much? Will we, with genetic manipulation and combination of genetics and machine technology, create something that looks like this? Some people think yes. By 2029, Kurzweil predicts that the typical computer will not equal one human brain, but 1,000 human brains. Okay? The human brain will be mostly decoded and uploaded. Direct neural pathways, human-machine pathways, will be common and in place. So that, in other words, you think to your computer, and hey, your computer can think to you. Of course, your computer won't look like your computer. What will it look like? I don't know. Who knows? 3D holographic displays will be everywhere. Yeah, nice, big deal, more eye candy. Nanobots will be sophisticated. So, in other words, tiny, tiny, tiny little computers, right? Or little whatever they are, will be very sophisticated. For example, to compile or decompile into any shape or substance, possibly, that you can think of. You could have little nanobots flying around your room and not even see them until they get a command and create new furniture in your house, or create, you want to have a lunch in a replica of the Taj Mahal, or whatever. And then when you're done with it, you snap your fingers and it's gone. This is what at least some people believe will be possible. Various implants to enhance our own human abilities so that good old-fashioned unenhanced Homo sapiens could be a thing of the past. Kurzweil thinks we'll have a lifespan of 120 years. Well, okay, I guess that might be nice. I don't know if that would be boring or not. I haven't decided. Computers will claim to be conscious. Yeah. And it's very possible that we will be accepting those claims to some degree or another. Yeah, we'll think, yeah, well, you're not conscious the way I am. Probably true, but it may not matter because it'll seem like it. What kind of world will that be? Then, I didn't even get into quantum computing, something I know almost nothing about, but I know there are people who know about it. And this is, although in its infancy now, in the next few decades, could become extremely significant in the shaping of our civilization. Basically, making computers of today look like, you know, the Gutenberg printing press to us. I'm not kidding. Based on not classical physics, but quantum mechanics, solving a virtual infinite number of problems simultaneously. I don't know how that's done, but there are governments spending a lot of money right now on quantum computing. What kind of world will that give us? Will we go out into deep space with this technology? Will we go there? Well, yeah, I think probably. I don't know if we'll go there. Maybe we'll create an artificially intelligent machine or artificially intelligent ship to do it, but we're going to go out there. Now, let's come back to our theme here of disclosure and other related things. One of the main messages we've been getting this week is that many of the aliens are telling us that they're concerned about our damage to the environment. I'm sure that that is true. because this earth is a very precious place. I mean, there may be a lot of life out there, but I have to think planets like our own are not a dime a dozen. We have an incredible abundance of biological diversity and water and heavy minerals and all kinds of wonderful things that would have to be of interest to others. And we are damaging it greatly. However, I think there's another reason why aliens would be very interested in this place, and that is because of us. All right, we are poised to reinvent everything that we are and to become extremely powerful. And we do ourselves a great injustice when we downgrade our own ability to compete with them. Because, yeah, in 1950, no way. 20 years from now, don't bet on it, okay? It could very well be that we're making a quantum leap right now to a level, I'm not saying of superiority or even parity, but maybe something close to that. You know, maybe this revolution that we're in is getting the attention of a lot of people out there. I would think so. This is also why major change in this entire field of UFO studies, alien studies, is inevitable. With the massive changes that we are creating right now in our civilization, it is going to be impossible to stop revelations from coming out, okay? I mean, think of it this way. The technological changes that we're seeing right now, in my view, are absolutely the main thing behind all the political instability in this world. Everything's changing so fast. No one has time to adjust to anything. Governments are in crisis everywhere you look in this world. And my own study of the recent history of government interactions with the UFO tells me that when there's political crisis, this is the prime opportunity for disclosure. Again, Paul Stone here earlier today in his very excellent lecture pointed this out with vis-a-vis the Soviet Union. When did a lot of that Soviet material come out? Circa 1990, 91, when the Soviet Union was in a runaway, almost spiral state of collapse, when opportunities arose in a very unique moment of history. Other moments have occurred. I've pointed out a number of times in the past when Francisco Franco of Spain died in 1975 or when Mao Zedong died in 1976. After our own Watergate scandal, opportunities arose and information came out. Those opportunities will continue because it's inevitable. It's the way our civilization is right now. It cannot be any other way. And the other thing is that new technologies are going to give us new tools to answer these old questions. You're going to wake up one morning and talk to your computer and say, hey, Marvin, you know, I've been wondering about this UFO thing. Now that I got your attention, can you, like, give me kind of a computation on the likelihood that aliens are here? And Marvin will say, oh, yeah, well, you know, you got 57 that are here. And, in fact, you got these and these and these and these. And yeah, it's obvious. I can tell. Could that happen? Why not? How can disclosure happen in the near future? Well, there could be undeniable, irrefutable evidence. Some of the lectures that have been provided earlier today, in particular the information provided by Jaime and Santiago, I thought were very, very compelling video images of UFOs. At some point, there could be a breakthrough. Yes, of course there could be. Hasn't happened yet, but there could be. Some other government might just want to trump the U.S. for some reason. Maybe. Hasn't happened. At least it hasn't happened successfully. I ask myself, to what extent does the U.S. control this issue globally? I don't know fully, but I suspect U.S. has very, very prominent influence behind the scenes with a lot of these governments. The main thing that I believe will cause disclosure will be some major crisis that will enable it or even force it. I don't know specifically which that crisis will be, but we are in a period of ongoing crises. And in fact, can there be one here in this country politically within the next couple of years? Some people think yes. Let me hold off on my prediction. Well, I don't think it will be in the next 2 years. I just don't. I think it's, you know, some of the problems that I laid out for you just a little earlier, some of the difficulties are not going to make this an easy decision for those people who have this secret. But that situation is not going to last forever. It can't. Will it be during the next presidential administration? If it's Hillary or Obama or Rudy Giuliani or somebody else, will they be amenable to a disclosure on UFOs? Well, I don't know. My suspicion is no. That's just my hunch. One of the reasons that I think that presidential administrations are next to irrelevant in these decisions. Maybe some people disagree with that. I think that, for example, when I was discussing earlier the deep black programs, one thing that I will point out to you is I also corresponded with Edgar Mitchell around the time that I contacted Admiral Thomas Wilson. I was trying to line all my ducks up. And one thing that I said to Dr. Mitchell was, this is in an email, I said, look, can you throw me a bone here? For the last 10 years, you have stated, for on the record, that you have two ultra-elite sources, confidants, who have told you about the existence of deep black programs to study alien technology and bodies. You've said this. He started making these statements, as far as I can determine, by the way, in late 1997, just a few months after the meeting with Thomas Wilson. I don't think that's a coincidence. So I asked Dr. Mitchell, very respectfully, if he would, if not tell me who these two people were or confirm to me, I suspected one was Admiral Wilson, but if he would tell me, or at least give me something to work with. And he wrote back and said, look, I support and I respect what you're doing, I really do, but I can't do this. And what he said was, the people who came to me, when they did so at great personal risk, and, he said, risk to their families. And I can't go back on that trust. Okay, well, that's what he said. Now, how do you interpret risk to the families? I can't think of too many other ways to interpret that rather than bodily harm. And if that's so, who are we dealing with? Are we really dealing with, like, the NSA hitmen coming after you? Or are we dealing with something a little more nasty than that? Guys who will come and kill you. Could they be private? This is what Stephen Greer has maintained for many years. I happen to agree with that. It looks to me that you've got private armies. They, I'm sure, have co-opted aspects of the U.S. military. Yeah, for their purposes, I could see that happening. But are there private groups? Yeah, I think so. And I think they scare the hell out of people who've got this secret. Now, if that is so, who's in control? I mean, you got a bunch of killer gangsters running this secret. That could be problematic as far as disclosure goes. And that's why I think presidential administrations may not be where the power is at. If I were to predict disclosure, I would say not less than 5 years, but not more than 25, and that's pushing it out a lot. I think it'll be sooner than 25. The only reason I went as low as 5 years is a concession to the year 2012. My feeling, though, is that I'm not seeing it happen in 2012, probably. I don't see it happen. I think it's a little bit too soon. I could be wrong. I think that when it happens, if it happens, let's say, more than 10 years from now, that it could well be an anticlimax. I mean, as strange as that sounds. You know, if Disclosure had been made in 1950, well, that's a big deal. Of course, in 1950, aliens would have been so far beyond us that it would have been the biggest thing in the history of the world. And it still would be a big deal any time that it's made. But the fact is that our own civilization, if things go, if we are able to survive this tightrope that we are on, that's the key. In other words, we're on this tightrope, all of us. We're walking really high up. And if we fall off this tightrope, it could be over for many of us. Falling off the tightrope meaning a global infrastructure meltdown of some sort. If, for example, cheap oil is gone before there's a replacement online sufficiently so that your supermarket might not get enough food on the shelves, or there may not be enough fresh water. China right now is going dry. Anyone following that story? India. We're having real big problems with water and with oil. And if we fall off this tightrope, who knows how far we could fall. But if we get to the other end of this tightrope, we're in for a wild ride. And that ride would include some of the things that I've just laid out for you in terms of intelligent machines and nanobots. And maybe there'll be a way to kind of tweak our psychic abilities too. All kinds of possibilities. So in such an environment, the knowledge that aliens are here might be, yeah, we kind of figured that one out all along. It might not be as big a deal. But I suspect that in any kind of political scenario that we have today, in which there's this entity known as the United States government and other governments and all of that, Disclosure is going to be very revolutionary. And the question is, it's like two forces of great power pushing up against each other. The force for secrecy and the inevitable historical forces of change that are going to force this issue somehow at some point. This is the impossible situation that the secret keepers see themselves. On the one hand, they must never reveal the secret. On the other hand, change is inevitable. And how that's going to play out, well, this is a drama that I think we will be seeing. One thing is to keep in mind, especially if Disclosure happens on the earlier end of the spectrum, as I see it, is that it will almost certainly be not entirely truthful. Like if there are admissions that are made, would it be a complete admission? Do I trust the President of the United States, whoever that person is, to give a full and complete and unadorned, unvarnished version of the truth? I don't think so. Doubt it. And so it will still be up to diligent researchers to stay on top of this issue. And don't make the mistake that researchers in the 1960s made when the Condon Committee was taking care of everything, right? And this happened. Researchers said, well, you know, the Condon Committee is going to solve it. And we all know what happened. The aftermath of Disclosure. Well, all I can do is speculate on how that might play out. Many people here at this conference believe it will be a new age, a good age. God, I hope so. It could be. It could be. I mean, one thing that sometimes we get ourselves into this idea that, well, they're not going to appear to us until we're ready. But if that happens, it's going to be a long wait. I think what can happen, though, I mean, really, right? But if they make themselves openly known to everyone, what could happen is that people understand that it is possible to be another way. And often change occurs when you realize that such a change is possible. And sadly, most people in this world don't have, their heads are not there. They don't recognize that it's possible to live a completely different kind of life. And it may be that only the example, an overwhelming example, kind of wakes people up enough to think, whoa, we can do this differently. We can be different. And maybe that will be the case. Could the aftermath bring a dark age? Well, I don't want to dwell on this. But look, I mean, anything is possible. We've got different forces here. And depending on what these, all of these others are like, some of these other beings, sure, I think they are, there are good, benevolent beings that are undoubtedly here. I've talked to many people, experiencers. And by the way, I think the distinction between experiencers and abductees is a perfectly good distinction. It's fine. I like both terms. Because some people do have positive experiences with these other beings, right? However, I can tell you I wouldn't want to leave my children in the room with some of the others. I wouldn't. So I don't think they're all good. I don't think they're all bad. And depending on how political developments in this world go, could we end up with an age of oppression? Well, it's a danger to watch out for, because every Eden has its serpent. Our job is to kill it. Will the new era be reserved for the next species of human, kind of the thing that I've been hinting at? I don't know. A combination of human-machine intelligence? I don't know, maybe. We appear to be quarantined here on this planet. Alien craft have been playing games with our spacecraft. Maybe they're just thinking, those humans, those unenhanced humans, they're not going anywhere. We'll wait for the next group, their creations. Just tossing it out there as an idea, I don't know. I'll say this, we are unquestionably living at the end and beginning of an age. What we're having right now is, there's never been anything like it. It's not like the Renaissance, which was a big deal. This is bigger. We've never had a situation like this in which we are becoming well aware that there are other beings who are here and interested in this world and in us, for good or for ill, for good and for ill, and we on the verge of becoming something very, very different and possibly very potent and dangerous, or possibly maybe very good. We're on the verge of a massive transformation. And whatever mode disclosure takes is going to have to take place within the context of a completely revolutionized world in every way. What I'm saying is that disclosure, open and free acknowledgement for everyone in the world of the existence of non-human intelligences living here among us is going to take place in a more revolutionary environment than perhaps we've imagined up till now. That's what I have to say for tonight. Thanks a lot. We do have time for questions and answers. In fact, oh, we don't have time. Do we have time for questions and answers?
Oh, a couple.
Oh, fast. Oh, I blew through the, yeah, sorry. If anyone's got questions, let's do this with dispatch. Yes, sir.
Testing. My comment and question has to do with a form of disclosure.
Can you speak into the mic so that everyone can hear you, including me?
The type of disclosure, the form of disclosure. We're expecting the government to come out with this formal statement. I think we're bucking a system, obviously, that's not giving in anytime soon. My point is that we're doing a very good job of disclosure right now, this whole meeting, all the meetings, all the right. DVDs, everything is being produced.
Right.
I think it should be, this disclosure should be on the private sector, not the government sector.
Right. Everyone hear that? Private, not public disclosure. I'm all for that. But I would also just want to remind everyone that it's a good thing for us to take control back of our public institutions. One reason that I believe in public disclosure is that I believe that it's still a good thing for us to think of ourselves as in control of our government. And so, thank you. Yes, you can clap for that. That's a good thing to clap for. That's a yay, as I tell my daughter. We have to force the issue. And ultimately, if we can make the government irrelevant, yes, let's do it. But the fact is that all the grassroots in the world is not breaking a media/government stranglehold on this issue. It's just not happening. So the question is, the issue is how to make that happen, how to make the two sides congruent with each other, the public and the private.
You can start with just a public announcement, followed by the comment, more study to follow, stay tuned, and then keep feeding the press more and more statements about our findings.
Okay.
I mean, when you consider that discovery of planets, oil, medicine, archaeology, new species, Jesus scrolls right. and tombs, all these things were in the private sector. You know, we're bucking a system that's not going to give in. I think it should be in the private sector, this disclosure.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's let the next person. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Richard.
What? How many more? Fast.
I think you're very correct. We are in a quarantine planet. And the reason why we're in a quarantine planet, through the book I read, the Arantia book, 500,000 years ago, Lucifer came to take over the world on behalf of God. He didn't do a very good job. He's now on a planet, Splendon. He's quarantined.
Okay, I have no problem with Urantia at all, but for this meeting, I don't think it's going to be.
No.
I'm short on time. What's your question?
My question is, until the accord is completed between us and the Lucifer rebellion, then we will be in a quarantine planet. And having said that, that's, I believe, is coming to a end very, very shortly.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next. Last. Two more. Quickly. Yes, sir.
Yes. two factors. I wonder whether they should be included, if you've purposely disincluded them. One being the Creator, God, some sort of supernatural intervention, and the second being the extraterrestrials that are so intricately involved with us, who have an agenda that's basically good, that wants to see us come out on the good side, not on the bad side. Those two factors I didn't really see in your presentation.
I thought I referred to the second one quite explicitly. You know, the nature of these extraterrestrials, whether good or bad, I think is a very important part of this. And that's really a true exopolitical question. The religious aspect I referred to, yeah, I think that I didn't get into it explicitly, but certainly the question of was Jesus an alien, for example, or were the great religious leaders of our time aliens? This is an issue. And it will certainly, there are going to be a lot of people in this world who will be deeply affected by the outcomes of that issue. So it's a factor, yes. Last question.
Thank you.
Last.
Hi, Rich. How you doing? Very nice. However, first of all, you talked about our human history and you didn't talk about Atlantis. All right, you started with the cavemen. That's kind of a limited beginning, don't you think?
Yeah, could be.
Okay.
I'm very interested in a lot of the issues about ancient history. I didn't get into Atlantis. I could have, I suppose. My point, though, is to show in the last 10,000 years, due to what archaeological evidence shows us, the origins of agriculture were approximately 10,000 years ago. That's a difficult point to argue against. That doesn't say there was no Atlantis.
Well, okay. The idea is that we might have been to this junction before as a human species, and we might have actually had to meet these factors before. That's just one suggestion.
Yeah, well, that's fine.
Suggestion.
That doesn't really change my point an awful lot, which is that we've just gone through massive, massive change in the last century.
Right, agreed. And then just one other thing, and that is, what about the possibility that you didn't talk about, that disclosure is happening as we speak, and that the aliens that are here interacting with us, and that we are their creations, and therefore we are partly alien ourselves, and that knowledge, that getting to know who we really are, is what this is all about, and that basically if disclosure is happening, we are the disclosure, and that disclosure is happening as we speak.
Well, I think that's a real possibility, that we are the aliens. I absolutely think that's a possibility, that we were created or have a very intimate relationship with them. Is that going on today? Yeah, maybe. There are always factions, Carrie. There are always groups that are trying to get information out. The question is, will they succeed?
But they are succeeding. We have children being born that are, you know, hyper-developed. They're populating the planet. In other words,
The
evidence is out there.
Okay. I'll take your point. Thanks.